first presentation will be from Corey Anton, who is going to talk about general semantics and YouTube vlogging. Corey Anton, professor of communication studies at Grand Valley State University, is author of Selfhood and Authenticity, Sources of Significance, World Rejuvenation, and Non-Stoic Heroism, Communication Uncovered, General Semantics and Media Ecology, and the editor of Valuation in Media Ecology, Ethics, Morals, and Laws. Past editor of the journal Explorations in Media Ecology and past chair of the Semiotics and Communication Division of the National Communication Association, Anton is a fellow of the International Communicology Institute and currently serves as the vice president of the Institute of General Semantics. I give you Corey Anton.
What an introduction, Wowie. Thank you so much. I'm here to report roughly on the beginning stages of a book that I have been working on new media, and I want to talk specifically on YouTube vlogging, and I guess some people don't really know what vlogging is, and so I'm going to try to talk a little bit about first how I got involved in YouTube, and I want to talk a little bit about some of the things that I've learned in my experiences and try to relate a lot of these concepts to basic principles in general semantics, and then I also am going to see if I can't give some sort of battle cry for people to perhaps join me and participate with me on the tubes. Okay, so first off, let me say something about how I got involved in YouTube. First off, I'm not a new media person. I'm not really a media person at all. I was more interested in dusty old books. I've been a dusty old book person. And Lance Strait, this is for Lance, I'm looking in the camera for you. Lance Strait contacts me and he says, "Oh, come on, Corey, open up a Facebook, open up a MySpace, open up a YouTube, get all these things and help promote media ecology, help promote general semantics." And the fool that I was, I opened these various things. I don't know that much about them. And I didn't really get Facebook. Didn't really get it. MySpace, don't really get it. YouTube, unfortunately, I guess it got me. It was sort of what happened. And I realized that YouTube was not at all what I thought it was. I think many of you here maybe go to YouTube. You know what that is. There's a thing online you can go and you can look for movies. But many people don't see it the way that I think we do. I think we see it, the bulk of us, we see it as an archive for videos. It's a kind of resource. It's a search engine. For many other people, that's not what it is at all. It's a community, and that's where they live. There are people who live vlogging, and they live their lives recording it and having dialogues with people all around the globe. And when I first got on YouTube, okay, so I got on about 2005 or 6, right when it came out, and I'm a juggler, so I put up some juggling videos, and I had a couple of rants about what language is, maybe some Korzybski stuff, and I forgot about it. I never really, didn't pay too much attention to it. And I looked back after several months, and I'd picked up, surprisingly, a couple of hundred subscribers, and I was like, huh, what is this? And then I contacted Mike Wesch, if anybody knows who that is, anthropologist, very involved in media ecology. He was a student of Edmund Carpenter's, and he had done a video that had gone viral, and it had many million views. And he then won a National Science Academy Award for his work on YouTube, so I contacted him. And I said, how do you make contact? How do you make this YouTube stuff work? And he said, well, a lot of it is you have to realize that you can't just post a video. You have to post responses to people. You have to be engaged in the YouTube community. And he says, basically, the strategy is to find a big-name YouTuber, wait until they post a video, and then you post a video response. And that's how it began. That's how it began for me many, many years ago. At this point, embarrassed to say, I have nearly 600 videos up. 600 videos. And I'm not even a serious vlogger. I'm like a part-timer. There are people who have thousands of videos on multiple channels. They can have 8 to 10 channels, and they'll have 1,000 videos per channel. People are literally living their lives with recording it, everything recorded. And I think, what I want to do is talk a little bit about what these are. Maybe I'll say a little bit more about how I got more involved in it. You know, when I first got involved in YouTube, I was trying to understand what it was. I saw it as a marketing platform for my books. I saw it as a way to maybe do some outreach and to promote some ideas. And when I first was involved, the platform of YouTube was very different. It would only allow you to upload 10-minute videos. That was the maximum length at the time. This was about maybe 2007, 2008. And so all my videos are, you know, 5 or 9 minutes and 58 seconds. I mean, right, whatever you could get in there, right? And all we wanted to do, all I wanted to do was make partner, because people told me that if you make partner, you are eligible to run advertising on your content. You get profit sharing. You also can upload a video of any length. So once I heard that, that was the early impetus to start uploading lots of videos. And I started doing lots of videos. I started building community. And in about 2009, I did make partner. Just as I was making partner, I was having the ability to upload videos of any length. I started calling people and recording dialogues on Skype and uploading hour and a half long dialogues and stuff. And again, it was really interesting. But again, the platform kept changing. And then they allowed anyone and everyone to upload videos of any length, and they also allowed anyone and everyone to profit share by posting advertising on their content, as long as it's, you know, isn't proprietary or they have the rights to it. And so that, I guess, it really changed the atmosphere of YouTube. So the community itself has undergone a pretty significant change. But I guess the thing that was most really apparent to me was that there really is a difference between being on YouTube and being a vlogger. Now, first way you can tell if someone is a vlogger or if they're on YouTube, their videos start something like this. Okay, I'm responding to so-and-so's response to so-and-so. You got a vlogger on your hands. Yeah, they're deeply embedded, and you will have this, you know, you're going to reference three other videos that you have to watch in order to understand what video that I'm going to talk about here, how it relates. And I guess to me, the reason I'm stressing that I think this is a kind of community is that it introduces different ways of binding space. That what we mean by bound space is really changing. That we see a global community, and you know, the community that I'm largely part of in YouTube is known as the theist-atheist debate. There's a whole bunch of people on YouTube who are arguing with one another about religion and or atheism. And I'm active in a lot of those debates. But when I say it's space binding, it's really interesting because many people, they go on to YouTube and they listen to people speak English. That's really their only interest in going to YouTube. They want to hear Americans speak English, and they want to get what American English sounds like. Again, it's putting people together in a kind of synchronized way across the globe. But I think that really covers over the much more significant insight that I would want us to really talk about. That's what I want to move toward, is the rise of asynchronicity. The rise of asynchronicity. And I'm gonna use a line here and let people try to think about this. Where everything is recorded, time remains unbound. Where everything is recorded, time remains unbound. I think there's something about what we mean by time binding that is really a kind of strategic forgetting. That's what time binding is. It's a kind of strategic forgetting. YouTube almost doesn't allow it. Everything is recorded and archived, and it's up there permanently. And I think the thing that's maybe even more driving this is it's a kind of context of no context. It's a context of no context. So imagine we're doing the structural differential or something here. Like, as we're here in this common situation right here, we have a common space, a shared time, and we can literally grow older together. I can be speaking to you, and I can see by your facial expressions you're following or not following, and may actually impact where this sentence lands. I mean, it's actually right here in the now. Everything you see on YouTube is a recording. It's a record of the past. It has the appearance of, hey, I'm talking to you, and we're right now in a shared interaction, but it's not. It's not like reading a book. Right? I mean, a book has asynchronous features to it. I mean, a book is very asynchronous, right? You read it at your own time. Right? But it's very different than the abstraction from context. And let me see if I can clarify that even further. Say I were to show, and I don't have any audio visuals here, but if I were to show a video to you, I think in some way the common context is often important when you show a video. I think some people who teach with videos, you might want to give it on a Blackboard site, but you say, no, I really want to make sure that people watch the video. Partly we say because we want them to have a fresh view, but I think it's more than that. We want them to have a shared context. YouTube never gives it. You can post your video, one person is watching it in their underwear while they're eating cereal in their basement. Another person is sitting in a kitchen table around a bunch of people and they're watching it collectively. For one person, it's midnight.
For some other person, it's 3 in the morning. For some other person, they're watching it, it's in the afternoon. And one person, they're watching it, it's a rainy day. One person, it's a cloudy day. And that actual video, all those people are watching it simultaneously. Because it's global, there isn't a shared context for the experience. And you can probably imagine the kind of semantic reactions and the craziness of YouTube. It's largely a Three's Company episode. Ever watch Three's Company? It's some person overheard a little piece of something, they blew all our context and they just run around with it. That's largely what YouTube is. It's a bunch of stuff out of context being blown out of proportion. People chasing it around.
Right, chasing it around. Let me see if I can explain that again, even a little bit more, about some of the ways that I'm, I don't want to say fearful, but I'm apprehensive of what the long-term implications of these technologies will be. And the simplest way for me to say it is I think all of these technologies, Facebook, YouTube, I don't know that much about Twitter. I was going to say I don't have a Twitter because I don't have a phone. Evidently, you don't need a phone to have Twitter. But I think all of these technologies, the best I understand them, are vulnerability management tools. That's what they are. They're ways that people are learning how to manage their vulnerability. Facebook, this is huge. Again, it's a vulnerability management tool. YouTube, it's largely what it is. You get control over what you're going to say. Like right here, right now, I could go up, and freeze right up. On the video, I just delete that out. I edit it. I get such control. I don't have to deal with people's looks going, what the hell are you talking about? I mean, literally, you get so much control. And try to think on the receiving end, right? People can just stop people mid-sentence. They'll delete people. Go on to the next video. Right? Let me see if I can talk about that. You know, I'm right now in the beginning prospect of working on a book with Bob Logan and Lance Strait on formal cause. Right? This is one of these causes of Aristotle. And I think I can sort of illustrate what we mean by formal cause and talk about how it's being illustrated in YouTube. Is Peter Berger has a great story of the difference between car people and horse people. Right? He said, now horse people, they anticipate a little bit of give and take. They get on the horse and they go, giddy up! And the horse just sits there. They go, giddy up! And then the horse takes off and they go, whoa, whoa! And then finally, after a while, the horse slows down. Compare that to car people. Car people, they get in there, they shut the door, they put the key in, they put it in, they turn it on, put it in gear, and hit the gas, hit the brake. Car goes, car stops. And he says, Peter Berger says, you really want to notice not how horse people and car people are on the horse and the car, but how that carries over into their everyday interaction with other people. That horse people, they'll come up to you and they expect a little bit give and take. You're going to be kind of unpredictable, incorrigible. You may say something that catches them off guard. Car people expect other people to go when they hit the gas and stop when they hit the brake. That sensibility is bleeding over into our lives 80 million fold. With these new technologies. That exact same phenomenon. I think YouTube is creating a utterly isolated person who is absolutely frightened of the actual synchronous moment of being with another and being vulnerable to that person. And so we have all these technologies of sort of asynchronously dealing with people on our time, stopping them, deleting them, going on to the next one. There's just so many different dynamics, I guess, that we could shake that out. So let me see if I can further out a little bit on this talk of how it's vulnerability management. And this is one of the surprising insights that I found on YouTube. That the community is really quite interesting. When you go look at the videos, there seem to be three kinds of vloggers out there, right? There's three kinds of vloggers. One is the, lack of a better word, I'll just call it the groupthink mass mind. That somehow people they watch whatever video happens to be popular, whatever video is getting lots of thumbs up, they go and they give it a thumbs up. It's sort of this, you're trying to be whatever's up and popular right now. This is sort of what people are involved in there. And there is a way in which, I guess, it's part of the ebbs and flows of news cycles and what's going on. But it does seem to be that people are... they're hiding from their own individuality or their own opinions by they don't even want to comment on a video until they see other comments on the video.
They don't really want to talk about other people. They won't give it a thumbs up until they see other people have given it a thumbs up. It's really sort of that part of it. Okay, second one that is, I guess, related to this vulnerability management is trolling. There's a whole thing called being a troll. Okay, a troll is a person who on YouTube, they're largely anonymous channels, right? It's so interesting because anonymity really plays an important role in YouTube. But a person can create what's sometimes called a sock or a puppet account. And a puppet account basically means that a person created a non-recognized user and then they say hostile and or rude things. And I'm gonna, I guess in the spirit of saying things that are, I guess, graphic or whatnot. First posted up one of my first videos, you know, just getting into it. Post my video, comment. Here's the comment. Person says, I want to smack your nose straight with my dick. I put, thank you. Oh yeah, you will get the most hostile comments coming out of nowhere. And you say, why is this person doing it? It's for attention. It's for and somehow to feel powerful. And then you try to get at this question of, what does it mean when people need anonymity in order to be powerful? Is this really what we mean by democracy? I mean, what kind of freedom of speech is it when the only way that people can express what they want to say is cloaking it under something like anonymity? Okay, the third one is, I guess maybe the most surprising one, is that it makes me very hopeful about the future, I guess if I could say it this way, is that there's an unbelievable amount of compassion on YouTube. It's unbelievable. I think there are so many people, and you will see the dregs of, I mean, there's a good number of people who are clinically mentally ill who are vloggers, and people love to hear their insane ramblings. And what's interesting is the number of people who will go to these people's channels and they will say, you look great today. Good for you. Good video. They find some way to, I guess, try to cheer these people up, to try to say it's not so bad, to try to say there's hope for you. And a lot of the videos they're giving, they're pretty bleak. They're pretty bleak. I think one of the things that maybe also is worth talking about here is that it's probably, for my best guess, it's the today, right here, right now, it is the best training ground and arena for studying and practicing semantic reactions. You will find no place richer because there's so many different backgrounds. Anyone at any, you know, from any background can say something to you. And it really does have, again, some very interesting dynamics in as far as trying to find middle ground. And so I'll just give you, maybe I'll leave with one example from mine, is that, you know, I've tried to eke out a position between the atheists and the theists. I basically came out, I shot a lot of videos and went, neither of you people make any sense to me. And I went, all you atheists are wrong here, wrong, 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 wrong. Theists, wrong, 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 wrong. And I've tried to eke out a position between. And you can imagine, you know, it's brutal at all points. But it's been really wonderful to be able to raise certain questions. You know, one of the questions that I've gotten a lot of mileage out of my videos, and I now have like over 10,000, about 11,000 subscribers. I have over a million views on my channel. I mean, it's really gotten, it's quite big right now. But one of the questions that I really like to ask people is, if you suddenly found out, just for argument's sake, if you suddenly found out there was no life after death, could you be happy? Could you forgive God, or are you angry? And boy, that kind of video really provokes people. On either side of the fence, it's been really wonderful to watch people react to that. And they react to it in so many different ways. It's been really wonderful. I guess my last thing I will say, and I will step out of here, is please join me on YouTube, people. Come on, open a channel. Help us educate people about general semantics. I do have a good number of videos on general semantics, on mediacology. I have been scheduled to do one with Bruce Kodish on his book. We're going to do a dialogue and try to promote that. Other people, if you have either a Skype account and you want to do a dialogue and record it and put it up on my channel, or if you have a channel and you want to be a vlogger with me, please join the forces. There's a whole new community out there doing this thing. Thank you.